How do humans try to hide from God? The next point in Paul's dissection of human motivations is that that people avoid God by creating idols. Mm. Those who reject the Creator try to find a God substitute in creation. And he talks about this in kind of verses 23 and 25 of Romans 1, that they, meaning all people, exchange the glory of the immortal God for images resembling mortal man and birds and animals and creeping things. They exchange the truth of God for a lie and worship the and served the creature rather than the Creator. So the fundamental decision we all face in the course of our lives is that we will recognize as ultimate reality the uncaused source and cause of our existence. So everything speaks to a worldview that depends on God, but we try and replace God with things that He's created, because that's kind of all that we have left. We definitely don't want to acknowledge Him because of our sin, of our sin nature. Yeah. And so we are designed in a specific way to worship and to have a source for kind of our beliefs and how we look at the world. Yeah. And so we end up replacing God with what the Bible terms is an idol.
Because the God described in the Bible, she says, goes against the grain of today's popular notions of spirituality, right? Many people may be receptive to the idea of a non-personal spiritual force, but they are far less comfortable with the concept of a living, active, personal God who knows them, wants to interact with them, and has his own view about what they are doing with their lives. And so who wants that kind of God? Right? So they create a God, we might say, for themselves.
Right. And we see this throughout Scripture. We see it as the first commandment, "You shall have no other gods before me." Why? It's because all their commandments hinge on this. If you don't believe God has authority over your life, then what does it matter when God tells you not to murder, not to steal, honor your father and mother, to keep the Sabbath holy? What do all those matter if there are other gods that compete for Yahweh's ultimate exaltation in the world?
Of course, they're false gods, right? They're not real gods.
Right.
Then that's what we mean by idols.
Right. Yep. Yep. There's not a pantheon that are fighting each other to get to the top spot, and who's ever king of the mountain, Zeus and them would hold a special place and usurp the biblical God. There are varying degrees of idols. There are false gods that have been kind of anthropomorphized. There we go. That's the word. Things like Baal and the Old Testament gods that seem to be like gods of the harvest or gods of fertility, or you know, you just look at the whole pantheon from Greek to Egypt to you know, all these different cultures. They have specific deities that seem to they acknowledge a superiorness of being, but it definitely falls short from what the biblical God claims about himself. So an idol is anything that we want more than God. Mm. Idolatry is thus hidden sin driving all other sins. So she gets into, for example, we feared the disapproval of people more than we want approval of God, so we lie. Mm.
The people then become idols in that situation, right? That
right.
causes us
yeah.
to do things that we ought
right.
not do.
Right, right. Yeah. We value our reputation more than we value our relationship with God. We try to manipulate someone into giving us something because we think we need that more than we need God. So all these things are driven by an invisible turn of our hearts towards something other than God as the ultimate source and security of our happiness. And I would point to, again, Mitch Stokes' How to Be an Atheist book that we covered for towards the end of it that we talked about this as well. We see this type of idolatry even in Scripture. It's not just bits of wood and rocks and stuff like that. In Habakkuk, it talks about how the Israelites view their military power as an idol. In the New Testament, there's sexual immorality is a byproduct of a person idolizing themselves and worshiping themselves in the world. So it doesn't have to be a thing that we think of. Oh, well, it's a little figure that we bow down to. There are ideas or statuses that we do. Pretty much idol is this kind of general catch-all for anything that would supplant
God,
right? Yeah. We sin because we want something in the created world more than we want the creator. And we do see this even in the psychological world where if you present a person with who has entrenched ideas, who have political thoughts that they are unwavering from, and they're given a study that's done that says what they believe isn't the case, they actually become more entrenched in that belief by seeing competing evidence. So people are really good at dismissing evidence, even if it might be good evidence, or evaluating it in a proper context or light, or taking value for what new evidence might come in that might speak against, but still it's not like they have to fully give up. That's a discussion of psychology, but we see that even in non-philosophical, theological ways too. So when good gifts are false gods is the section. Martin Luther writes, to that to which your heart clings and entrusts itself, I say, really is your God. So that's kind of the general.
Something good,
right,
if it takes the place of God, can become an idol.
Your family, your children, anything that would take this place. You know, would I rather be to evaluate my life based on my ultimate meaning that I go to, or am I ready to kind of give that over and say, okay, here's an avenue of my life, like my job might become an idol, or something that is important that isn't that we would look at and say, oh, like prostitution, that's really bad, we definitely shouldn't do that, or you know, work hard but then work over hard, and then put that in place of, you know, going to church or doing your Bible study.
All of a sudden work becomes
right. So she goes on to say that Paul describes this in when he's writing to the Philippian church as people whose minds are set on earthly things, whose God is in their bellies. They are driven by sheer physical appetite, even if they are cover their cravings under the veneer of sophistication. So it doesn't have to just be something that's done. It can be also a physical being, like food or sex or whatever, drink. Drunkenness is spoken a lot in the Bible. That can also become an idol. John Calvin defines idolatry as worshiping the gifts in place of the giver himself.